And we also discussed about what is the intelligence. And we said that the father of AI is a British mathematician. His name is Alan Turing. And the real term AI, artificial intelligence, was coined by John McCarthy in 1956 in the Dartmouth conference, which was held. We discussed last week about AI having different umbrella subjects under it, and the main subject that was there in AI was machine learning, and then we had speech, we had natural language processing, we had robotics. All these fall under the preview of AI. And then we discussed about the types of learning which are there in AI. And there are mainly three different types. You can see the slide on the different subject areas which are there in AI. And you can see that there are many different subject areas like machine learning, deep learning, natural language processing, speech, expert systems, robotics, computer vision. And these are all constituting of AI. And we cannot be expert in all the subjects. But the beauty of machine learning is that machine learning can be applied to any of the areas which are there in AI. And whether that be speech, whether that be computer vision, whether that be robotics, whether that be natural language, all these areas are going to apply the machine learning. And then we discussed about AI being the broad subject area. And then we also discussed that under AI was machine learning. And then under machine learning, a specific area was deep learning. And when we say deep learning, we are saying that how our brain is working basically with the neurons. And that's the area of deep learning, which is there under machine learning. So machine learning being the big bubble, and under it, there is deep learning, which is there. And surrounding this, there is AI. AI is the broad umbrella. So we also discussed last week about the different types of learning which are there. And the different type of learnings which are there are mainly of three types. One is the supervised learning, in which there is some supervision by one of the persons, like for instance, your mother taught you how to walk. And then, for example, there is unsupervised. Like for instance, we don't know if it is a round object, whether it's a coconut or whether it's apple. And we simply say that it is round, that's unsupervised. And reinforcement or semi-supervised learning, we simply say that it's a mix of both. And when a reward is given, then it's correct. Then when a punishment is given, at that time it's wrong. So these are the three different types of learning. We discussed about all this in detail, and any questions that we may have at this point of time from the last day lecture. Any question that you may have from the last day, please unmute yourself and then ask a question. And then we'll be going to the next topic. that is one of the different types of learning that is there in machine learning. Okay, sure. Can you please go ahead? Okay. Can you please go back? Okay. Stop. Next, please. And then stop. Okay. So today, what we are going to do is we are going to discuss about one of the types of learning in machine learning, and that is known as supervised. That is also known as classification. And in classification, we have different type of algorithms which have been developed over a period of time. I always come back to the algorithms because learning is nothing but a set of rules which are there. And here in case of supervised learning, there are a set of rules or algorithms which are there. And in classification, what we are doing is we are finding the decision boundaries, and we are saying that a particular object belongs to a particular class or not. This will be more clear to you in the next coming slide, for example. But you have to understand one fundamental aspect, and that is the aspect of the fact that it is supervised. That means it is something that has been seen in the past. And that's how we are basically going to say that a particular data point, it belongs to one of the classes, and that class is basically that we are saying is going to be the class for the particular data point. And that's how we say that we are going to supervise it. So some of the algorithms are there in the area of classification, which I want you to know. And then what you have to do is for this session, we are going to deal in Python. And when we are dealing in Python, we are going to say that the things that you'll do is basically in Python. And Python is very easy. Basically, when you take data science, there are two languages which are very, very commonly used, and one is Python and one is R. R being the one which is mainly for the statistical users who are good at statistics. But Python is very easy, and that's where you need to do all the types of different types of learning, all the different types of algorithms, and we will ensure that you install Python in your laptops, and then you do this particular types of learning or algorithms, which we say, and then demonstrate to us in the next Saturday class. Okay, over to next. Let us take a decision tree. For example, if I were to play golf or not, then I look at some of the factors. Like, for example, I look at what is the temperature, what is the humidity, and what is whether it's windy or not. And then also look at the outlook. So these are my predicted variables. These are my x1, x2, x3, and xn. So depending on these particular axes, which are the predictors, my target variable has been affected in the past. In the past, for example, the outlook was rainy and the temperature, humidity and windy was hot, high and fall. Then I did not play golf. So taking this particular thing is what is the result. So y is equal to f of a function of x1, x2 to xn. And what is this x? This x are nothing but temperature, outlook, humidity, and winding. So I'm going to form a decision tree, which you can see on the right hand side. And when I form the decision tree, I can clearly say that I'm going to traverse, go into the decision tree, and then I'm going to determine whether I'll play golf or not. So I just want to tell you that the very first, in the case of supervised learning, is basically the decision tree that you must have learned earlier also. And that's what we are going to use in machine learning a lot of times. And then machine learning is said to be supervised. In this case, we can say that the decision tree is helping us to come to the end result. So it's a means of the supervised learning that we are going to have. Over to next. Next page. Now, when we are saying regression, what is actually regression? That is one of the important concepts that we need to know. And when we say regression, it is nothing but determining a particular variable with the help of the independent variable. For example, say stock price. When we say yesterday the stock price was 100 rupees, then we can easily say because of this factor, the price of stock after 6 months will be so and so, 150 rupees. Or it may be just 75 rupees. That is what we have done. And we have used regression in this case. And then we say that regression is a mechanism of supervised learning. And when we say regression, it is basically of two types. A simple regression, linear regression. And why do we call it linear? We call it linear because it follows a line. Y is equal to mx plus c. Then when it follows a simple line, we can say it is simple linear regression. In this case, what is happening is, in the case that we vary the x, which is the independent variables, then the value of the simple linear regression is going to give us a new y or a output or a dependent variable. And this particular dependent variable is dependent on the independent variables, which is nothing but x. And it follows the particular equation of y is equal to mx plus c. That is a particular line that you have learned. And when this happens, we call it the simple linear regression. And when the y, which is the dependent variable, is dependent on several of the independent variables, like, for example, x1, x2, x3, x4, and xn, then we call it the multiple linear regression. And in this case, in the next slide, you will see that multiple linear regression is being called. Can we go to the next? Now, in this case, you see what is the dependent variable y, which is dependent on mx plus t. And then when we say that beta naught plus beta 1 plus epsilon, epsilon is something that we use the random error for. And then we say that beta naught and beta 1, and beta naught is basically the intercept which is there. The first one, m x plus c. And so that is what you are seeing, that it is following a straight line. And then when we say this, it is basically a simple linear regression. So simple means simple because it just follows the line. Linear means it follows the line. And regression means that what we are going to do is we are going to derive the value, that is, we are going, what is the, for example, what is the stock price going to be after 6 months or so? So this is the example of simple linear regression. And we can say that it will follow this particular equation wherein there is a single x and there is a error term also, and it follows a particular straight line. Can you go to the thing? Now, in the case of multiple linear regression, what happens? In the case of multiple linear regression, the dependent variable y is dependent on several factors and several independent variables, x1, x2 to xn. When such is the case, then we can say that it is called a multiple linear regression. In this case, the value of y, which is the dependent variable, is dependent on several independent variables, x1, x2 to xn. And in this case, we also fix some of the coefficient, that is beta naught, beta 1, beta 2, and so on to the terms. And then at the end, we also fix something which is known as the random error, because an error will exist in a particular machine learning problem. So in this case, this is known as the multiple linear regression. Can we go to the next? Okay. I just want to tell you, there is something known as the logistic regression also. And the logistic regression is going to have a value of either a zero or a value of one. When we say it is the value of zero, it is basically saying that although we said that this particular case may be there or may not be there, it will definitely not be there. That means it is zero. And if the case is there, then it is basically going to say this particular case is of the case of one. So this is a logistic regression. In this case, we'll have the outputs y, which is either a zero or a one. And in the case of linear regression, you have seen that the output follows a particular straight line, and this straight line equation y is equal to mx plus c. So in the case of logistic regression, the output will either be zero or the output will either be one. That means it's a logical thing which is there. These are all examples of supervised learning that I'm giving you at this point of time. And we have to remember that supervised learning is nothing but classification that I am trying to do. And I'm trying to tell the machine that this is the particular data that I have seen in the past. And because I have seen this particular data, all the next cases that basically come in are going to follow this particular rule. And when I say that what is the percentage of the data which I am going for learning, that is, for example, training and, for example, testing. Generally, the industry standard is 70:30. That means 70% of the data I am going to keep for the classification, for the training purposes. And when I am saying the rest of the 30% is what I am going to do for the testing purposes. So that is the thing which is there. Now, let us go to the next one. This is what I have jumped a few slides, and I just want to tell you all today about what is the clustering part of it, that is the type of learning which is there, and then about the neural network, which is basically nothing but deep learning or reinforcement learning, which is there. Now, if somebody asks you about the different type of classification which is there, you definitely got to tell him what we have discussed is about the decision tree, about the regression, and there are several different algorithms which are there. Like when you say classification, you will say decision tree in which you decide upon training the machine and then giving the output variable also to that. You will also tell him that there is support vector machine which is there as one of the classification methods, and that's what we use. And when you do it in Python, at that time, it is very easy because you do it and there are libraries which are going to take your data and then going to do the particular classification of things. And when they are doing the classification of things, it is, you need not know about what the internals are. And then when you don't know about what the internals are, the machine is going to automatically take care and then give you the result. So classification, for example, is one of the most commonly used, and that's the reason that there are several different algorithms which are there in classification area. For example, decision tree, for example, support vector machine, and that is what we all need to know about. But we don't need to know the details, because what is going to happen is, if you give it to the Python program, then the Python program will automatically go ahead and give you the result of this particular classification, or which is known as supervised learning. In the case of unsupervised learning, for example, we can say that we are going to have do clustering. And K-means clustering is one of the most common things that we are going to use. And when we are saying K-means clustering, we are talking about a particular data which is there. And I'm going to say that if the object follows so and so parameters, if they are there, then the object is round. So and so persons are there, for example, which have eye, which have ear, which have nose, 2 ears, then we can say that he's a man. And now where that man is from, that I don't classify, or that I don't bother. If I do not bother, then I can cluster them that he is a man. And this is one of the unsupervised learning that the machine also learns. And we also tell the machine that if he has 2 eyes, two ears, and a single nose, a single mouth, then the person is basically going to have we can put him in the broad category of a human being. And also it is possible that if it's an animal, then a tail is there. So on so forth, we can do the clustering. Now, that is one of the unsupervised learning which is there. And we have to be familiar that some of the algorithms are there. For example, K-means clustering. We saw that big chart, and that big chart depicted all the different algorithms which are there. Now, going to reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning is simple. For example, when you reinforce that some of the activities that are done by a particular person are basically going to give him a reward, then we say that's a positive activity. Some of the activities which are going to be a punishment are the negative activities. And at the time, we can say that it is a type of punishment that he has returned. He has got. Yes. Yes, sir. That is okay. That's right. I'll tell you, Sudhakar. So now we know about the supervised learning and the unsupervised learning and the reinforcement learning, which is also the different type of learning which are there in the area of machine learning. Now, let us go a little deeper. And we see that's the reason that we say it is deep learning. And in the case of deep learning, we are going to have a lot of data which is required for deep learning. And as you can see, that in the case of deep learning, a lot of data is really required. For example, if you are going to estimate how much the house rent you should pay, the house rent that you should pay is depending on various factors. On the factors like how many bedrooms are there in the house, how many square feet is the house, what neighborhood is the house, and then you will associate weight to that. For example, the number of bedrooms which are there, you may associate some weight to that. For example, in this diagram, if the number of bedrooms are 3, then that person has given the weight of 0.123. So you can see for the square feet that the house is empty, he has given a weight of 0.41. And then for the neighborhood, that is whether there are schools, whether there are shops, whether there are offices nearby that particular house or not, and then he has given a different weight. And for all these factors, the house rent is calculated through the method of deep learning, and that is what we usually do the price estimate for. You see that there are several different factors and there are several different weights that we give and we estimate the price. This is the fundamental of deep learning that we will be using in going in the all the algorithms going forward that we use in the area of deep learning. Next. Okay, sir. Yes. For example, let us see a brain. And this diagram represents the brain. When we are saying that what is the final price estimate that we have, and the price estimate that we have is dependent on several of the factors, and the several of the factors, they have their different weights, and when they have their several weights, we just find out what is the final price of the house, which is that. That means to say, we are going to have one of the hidden layers. Now refer to the diagram which is there on the right of this slide. And we can see that one of the layers which is there in the middle is basically the layer of the temporary value. It means to say that what we are really doing is basically based on the inputs, we're going to have a temporary value for each of the factors that we have considered. And then for each of the factors that we have considered, where these temporary values are going to add up and we're going to have a final price. This is the way really our brain works that way. The brain has something which is known as the neural networks, and that is the idea that we have copied, and we call it the ANN, the artificial neural networks that we basically have on the pen and the paper. And then when we have on the pen and paper the artificial neural networks, ANN as we may call that, and then we have some of the temporary values, and these temporary values are basically calculated by the temporary factors that we have in mind. And then finally, we get a price. This is the fundamental of deep learning, which is there. And that's why we call it that there are several layers which are there, which are hidden layers. And these layers are basically not known to anybody. But these layers play an important role. The main thing is basically the input and the output, which we all see. And that is why it is basically known as the hidden layers, which are there in the middle of the input and output. This is basically the fundamentals of deep learning, which is there. Over to next thing. Yeah, this, what we have done is we have depicted how our brain works. And when our brain works, we basically have the input and output, which we all see. And what we do not see is basically the processing that is happening within. And the processing is happening in the hidden layer. Suppose it is a single layer, hidden layer, which is doing the processing, then we call it the simple neural network, or the neural network which is having the hidden layer equal to 1. And as you can see out here, the diagram on the left is basically showing us that the hidden layer is equal to 1. So it is a simple neural network. When the hidden layer is more than 1, then we call it deep. Why we call it the deep? We call it deep because what is going to happen is in the hidden layer, the processing which is there it will take place, and then the output will basically come. So we give it the input, and the deep, that is greater than one, hidden layers are basically going to do the processing. And when they do the processing, the output is basically comes out. So we call it the deep neural network is what we call it. And hope you are clear about the different type of learning which are there, the supervised, the semi-supervised, the reinforcement learning, and the deep learning which is there, which is happening similar to our brain. This is basically the fundamentals of machine learning, which are there. And deep learning is a subset of machine learning. And the reason that deep learning has come up is because we have mimicked our brain. And when we have mimicked our brain, we have tried to see that the way our brain is going to make the decision and give us the output is what we try to do. The computer, and when the computer is going to give a decision based on the different factors, then we are saying, going to say it is a deep learning that we have used. Next. Now, when we are saying deep learning, what really are we going to have? In deep learning, we are going to have a large amount of data. As you can see, and you must have felt that from the previous example, when you're going to make a simple decision, like house rent of a property, the house rent of a property is dependent on several of the factors. And what we do is basically assign simple weights to each of the factors that we have in mind. And when we are saying that we are going to do a house rent estimation, but we are going to have several factors, that means I'm going to have more amount of data when I'm making a simple decision. And when I'm making a simple decision, as you can see, deep learning, the amount of data which is there and is required for the deep learning part of it is basically the amount of data is huge, and that's why we call it deep. And that is what we want to say, that the other types of learning algorithms which are there, they are going to give us some type of results. The results are basically determined by the different factors which are there. And we can say that the other algorithms of whether it be supervised or whether it be unsupervised, they will give us the result. And that is why we are saying that deep learning requires large amount of data than the other algorithms which are there. So we can say that when we are going to use deep learning, definitely need more data, and the models which are getting created out of this particular data, and then more computation. And when we say that we are going to estimate the house rent of a particular property, and then we are going to have a large number of factors that are there, we can say that more computations are there because of this particular reason. So over to the next, please. Okay. So what we have done today is we have seen the different types of learning in machine learning, which are there. And if you have any questions, you can ask at this point of time. Can we go to the algorithm slide, please? I just want you to know. Can we go to the algorithm slide, please? I just want you to know that when you're talking about the different machine learning algorithms, you have basically to remember some of the things, that there are different types of learning which are possible. One is the supervised learning, one is the unsupervised learning, and one is the reinforcement learning, and also deep learning is a part of machine learning in which more and more data is basically required. And how do we basically go ahead with this particular learning part? In this learning part, we use this particular algorithm which are there. For example, when you use simple classification or supervised learning which is there, you can say that you are going to use the decision trees for that. And different type of decision tree are there, as you can see in this particular chart. And different type of decision tree is basically C4.5, C5.0. It's like these are the different type of decision trees which are there. And when I'm saying, for example, a different type of learning is there, which is deep learning, I can say that I'm going to use the different algorithms which are there. Like, for example, the deep Boltzmann, the deep belief networks. So these are the different type of algorithms which are there, and convolution neural networks. I'm going to talk about convolution neural networks also. Is what I'm saying is that when we are using images at this particular time, the convolution, that is, for example, I convolve through this particular images that are there, and then I basically do my learning of the cat image or dog image which I want to learn. And that is what is the mechanism of deep learning. And that is how I basically have different types of learning, and different types of learning are very, very important. And through the uses of the particular algorithms which are there, I can do different types of learning. Sometimes it may be required that I need to use more than one different type of algorithm. And why it is required? It is required because a particular algorithm will give a particular result, and then giving this particular different type of algorithm will give a different result. And sometimes I may need to use the same algorithm more than once. And when I use this algorithm more than once at the time, I use something which is known as the ensemble modeling. And when I use this particular ensemble modeling at the time, I use the algorithm more than once. And if I use it more than once on different results, which are given by the different iterations of the algorithm, I get the particular things, results, which I then go ahead and ensemble it. I add it together, or in some ratio, I do take those particular results, and then I will get the final result. And I want to say this particular thing, that ensemble is something which I really use. So as you can see, there are a wide number of algorithms which are there, and for all the different learnings which are there, whether you call it the supervised or the unsupervised or deep learning itself, then we use the different algorithms which are there. And the human brain also does similarly, as the algorithms are there. And that's where we say that machine learning is nothing but a set of algorithms that I need to use on a particular data. And when I use them on a particular data, I get a particular result. And when I get the particular result, I can say that I've learned about the algorithm a little bit about what he said. That is the way the machine learning algorithms work. And today, we just came to know about the different types of learning which are there in machine learning, which are basically dependent on the algorithms. And we can say that if somebody is asking you about the machine learning algorithms, then you can tell him that broadly, there are of three different types. One is the supervised, one is the semi-unsupervised, and one is the reinforcement or semi-supervised type of algorithm. And we have to remember that we have to give examples of one or two different types of algorithms which are there in each of the category. That is, it exists. And deep learning is something which is a different type of learning, which is basically dependent on how brain works. And that's how we basically use the particular deep learning algorithm. And for deep learning also, we have several of the different examples. And these particular examples, that is where you need to tell and you need to use in your things when you do about machine learning. Any question, please? Any question, please? Okay. We'll jump on to the next topic. And the next topic is basically about a particular language that you should be using for the different assignments that are given to you in the field of machine learning. And the language that is used most popularly is basically Python or R or SAS. But we will not use SAS or something because these are too costly and these are to be paid. Sudhakar sir, I just want to ask you one question, that has Python been taught to these particular students? Python been taught to these particular students, sir? Okay, sir. I'll just revise before giving you this particular assignment or in the area of Python. And for the Python workshop, I have a particular slide which I would like to revise. Okay. Sir. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Is everybody able to see my slide? Ah, yes, sir. Sir, are you able to see my slide? Yes. Since you have already learned Python, I'm just going to revise Python out here. And I just want to say, for the sake of machine learning, that Python is used, or R is used, or SAS is used, but we are not going to go to all the languages which basically involve money. And we are just going to use some of the open sources, and Python and R are some of the open sources that are used for machine learning. And that's why I'm revising this particular Python for you. Since you have already learned Python in your course, it is very easy for you to go ahead and install Python on your laptop and then go ahead and do this particular assignment which are given to you. Just for the sake of revising, I'm just walking through this particular slide. And please do let me know. Now, what is the advantage of Python? Python, the advantage is that you basically find Python as very, very easy. And it is just like English. And it was invented by Guido van Rossum. And this particular gentleman, he invented it when he was just sitting during his Christmas holidays at the National Institute for Mathematics and Computer Science. And that was in particular Netherlands is what he was. He has developed this. And this particular Python is basically very, very easy to learn. And it is a mix of languages such as ABC, C, C++. And there are, the good part of Python is that there are several licenses, several libraries, which are very easy to use, and we can get the result from them very, very quickly. Now, just to know about some of the basics of Python, it is an object-oriented language, and this particular language has basically simple data types, which are lists, dictionaries, strings, and there are loops and condition, for loop, while loop, and there are functions also, and the list of hash tables. Now, some of the advantage that we are having from Python is that it is free, and it is very powerful. Some of the libraries in Python are so powerful that if you simply go ahead and install a particular library of Python, then we should be able to work and we should be able to get the result. And there is huge community which is basically supporting Python, and huge community of people who are basically contributing to Python. And that is the reason that we are using Python. And Python is very, very strong language. And some of the companies, as you can see, Google, NASA, Yahoo, are some of the companies which are using Python. This you must have already known. And we just wanted to let you know that there is something known as CPython, which is basically written in C, C++. And you are, I hope all of you are using the latest version 3.x in this particular version of Python is what you are using. And I just want to say that you should use the latest version of Python, which is there. And the latest version is 3.6 or 7, 3.7 at the moment. But it is okay if you use 3.x version on your laptop, and then if you do your assignments in them. You could use any one of the environments, like for example, you could use Jupyter, or you could use PyCharm, or you could use Spyder as one of the IDE for doing Python. And there are several different IDEs, like you can see on the screen, that you can use for doing the Python. And there is something known as Jupyter. And when you are using the Jupyter, it is nothing but known as Julia and Python terminal. And you can use the Google Colab also. In the Google Colab, what is really going to happen is that in each of the cells, you're going to run Python. And when you run that, you will get your result. And then you can get the result in some other editor, for example, in Notepad. As you can see, these are some of the Python editors, the interactive development environments, like for example, the Spyder, in which I have written the Python programs. And then in one of the windows, I'm going to get the result. And you can see a third window in which I'm going to see the different type of uses of the particular functions which are I'm using in my program, which is writing towards the left-hand side. So the program is on the left-hand side, and you can see that all the results are on the window on the right-hand side for my program that I have written using Spyder ID. You can also have some of the windows, some of the other tools like Anaconda Navigator or Jupyter. You can have and you can use them to go and write your Python programs. You can also use PyDev, and you can say that if you know Python, for example, if you are an expert in Python, you can say that you are a hotcake in the industry. Now let us learn some of the things of Python. And when we say hash exclamation slash user bin Python hello world, we are doing nothing but we are trying to print the hello world program by itself. And then when you are going to use the interactive cell of Python, at the time we can give the simple things and the result will come out same. For example, we can say 5 + 6 × 8, and the result will come out instantaneously. There are many of the data types and structures, and there are many of the control and IO, file IO modules and classes, and natural language toolkit, which are there. In the case of you are using Python, it's very easy to go ahead and use them. For example, let us say that you are using some of the things to go ahead and print the result. Then when you're printing the result, you are basically going to have the outputs which are shown out here. For example, if you say print the value of pi, it is going to use the value of pi that I have already fixed, 3.1415929. And then going to go ahead and print it. So we are going to use different variable types in Python, and then we are saying that this particular variable types are the variable types that we can use in Python. And for example, we can use string, for example, we can use float, and the different variable types are what you can use using our Python. As you can see out here, that he has tried to print the value of what actually is the string, and then he has used type, and the type will give the type of the variable that's there, which is either float or string or the integer. And you can also convert from one type to another, and that is very easy using some of the Python script. I'm just revising it. I know that you've learned Python as a subject in one of the courses, and that's why I'm just revising, because I'm going to give you assignment in this particular machine learning, which is basically you have to do in Python and then show it to me. I hope that you have not deleted the Python installation, which is already there in your laptop. Okay, now let us see one of the Python types, which is basically a list. And you can see that when you are trying to have a list in Python, it is basically nothing but the different type of variables that are there is what you can put in Python in a list. And when you try to print the list, you will get all the different items which are there in the list. Or when you are trying to print the length, you will try to get the length of the different items which are there. For example, in the list, you have the names as three different type of names. And when you print the length of the names, then it gives a list value of three. Similarly, I can basically index also the items which are there in the list. For example, the very first starts with the name with the 0, 1, 2, 3. And when I say -1, it is basically the last one. When I say -2, it is basically the second last. And when I say -3, it is basically the third last. Like, you can also go ahead and try to have certain strings which are there. And when you're putting the items in a particular list, and in the list, you are trying to have these strings which you are sharing, then you can easily go ahead and try to have the particular variable values that you are having in a particular list. You can also use certain of the functions, for example, the split function. You can also, for simple printing, you just use simple print. And when you print it, it is printed on the screen. For example, you could also open a file, and then when you are trying to print to a particular file, then you need to write to a particular file. There are certain string operations that you can do using Python. And then when you can do use the string operations using Python, at the time, it is very, very easy, and Python language can be used. You can use rstrip, which is nothing but the right strip, and the L strip, they are going to remove some of the white spaces or the blank spaces which are there. These are some of the things that I'm revising for you once again. And the reason I'm revising is simple. The reason I'm revising is because all the assignments that we do in machine learning are basically going to be done using Python. Of course, we could use R, we could use SAS, but we are not going to use or we are not going to use SAS in this particular class, like we have already told you, we will be doing all our assignments using Python and Python version 3.x. Mostly if you have, and if you download and install it on your laptop, then we can say that we are going to use 3.x in the particular experiment that we are going to perform. Tuples, it is a sort of immutable list, lists which cannot be changed. These are some of the features and data types of Python which is there. We can also zip the list together. And when we zip the list together, we are doing nothing, but we are basically combining the list which is there. And dictionaries are something which are one of the features of Python. And when we say dictionary, we just say a particular code we give to a particular long form that we are going to have. And then when we are referring to the code, we are doing nothing but we are referring to the long form which is there. For example, if I say India, and if I say the capital is Delhi, India colon Delhi, then we can easily say that what are the capitals that I have given. That for India, I have given Delhi, and for USA, I have given Washington, D.C. So I can easily create a dictionary like this, and then when I create a dictionary like this, I can easily go ahead and have the capital very easily of a particular country. So here you can see, for example, he has said P for Python, R for R language, J, S for Scala, and J for Java. So he can easily get it from the dictionary. Now, when we are saying control flow, at this particular time, what happens is that the value is false or true. The value is either an empty string, and the flow will happen because it is getting a certain input, and then it will basically take the particular direction of the flow. We can also have some of the loops, which are basically cumulative loops. And these loops are going to run for a certain number of times until that particular condition is met. And you can see that we are going to have an if loop. A if loop is basically if the particular condition is satisfied, then we are going to have a certain number of statements which are going to execute. I am just browsing through it in particular fast pace, and that is because you have already learned Python, and I'm just revising it. Okay. Then you have the while statement in Python, and while the condition is satisfied, while the condition is true, then certain of the statements need to be executed. And as you can see, the flowchart is also indicating that if the condition is true, then the particular statement shall be executed. This is the example of while loop. And then for the Boolean logic, we can say that if the condition is true, that means if the value is coming out to be 1, then this particular loop need to be executed and it is true. This is the value of the Boolean logic. The for, the statement goes like this, for a particular variable name in the group of values, then a certain number of statements will be executed. And when this for loop is not true, then this example will not be executed. In the case of tuple, it's immutable. We cannot change the order in which the tuple is happening, and we can change in case we want to change the list. For break and continue, for break, that means the program will break at that particular point, and for continue, this program shall continue in that particular place where you give the continue statement. Range is a set of values that we want to use in our program, and we can use the range. Now we can also use range in the stop and start statement. And for the range that we have, that is a set of values that we have. For the file input output, we can use the file, we can open the file, and we can write to the file. We can read from the file, which is there. And then we can also process the file by opening the file and reading line by line, or reading word by word, or reading alphabet by alphabet in the line which is here, in the file which we have opened. And these are certain statements that you must have already read. And when we are trying to write to a file, we can write, W is the write mode that we can use, and we can write to a particular file. The advantage is when we write to a particular file, if it is Excel file, if it is a particular file, which is a Word file, or if it is a notebook file, then we can preserve it. And we can ensure that we are basically going to read it at a later point of time. We also wanted to state that certain modules are there that when we import into the Python program, then we will get all the functions which are there. For example, when we are importing math, then we'll get all the different functions that are present inside the math library. When we are importing the NLTK, the natural language, then we can say that we'll be having all the functions that are there in the natural language toolkit, which are there. So these are some of the different math functions that we have depicted for you on slide. For example, the absolute, the ceiling. The absolute is the absolute value, and the ceiling is the basically the ceiling value, and the floor is basically the floor value. This all is what you must have learned when you're learning this Python. So these are some of the math functions that are there inside the Python. Since Python is object-oriented, we can easily say that some of the classes which are there are basically exhibiting the function features of the classes which are there, and that is what we can easily get out of writing the Python language. NLTK is basically the natural language toolkit, and when we use NLTK in our Python, for example, it becomes very easy to process the natural language which is there. And when we are processing the natural language which is there, we can basically go ahead and do all the operations like stemmatizing, stemming, limit as in, and then we can do all the operations which are due for the natural language. And when we say if we install NLTK at the time, we are basically installing the NLTK library which is there, and then we can say import of NLTK, and then we can do all the NLTK operations which are there. Tokenizing means each of the tokens which are there are basically going to be given to us, and it is very easy when you are doing the NLTK. Given the input of a particular sentence or a particular para, we can go ahead and tokenize it, we can go ahead and lemmatize it, we can go ahead and term it, or so on and so forth. We also wanted to tell you that WordNet is a particular library or a particular set of words that are there in the NLTK. And when you are using NLTK, you can basically get the synonyms of the particular word. Synonyms are basically the words which contain the same meaning, and antonyms are the words which are going to maintain an opposite meaning. And stemming is basically, for example, when we are saying the rule, the working is one of the words, and then we are saying stemming, we are basically going to have nothing but the root word of the word that we have given. For example, the root word of working is nothing but work. Lemmatizing. When we are lemmatizing, when we can say that, for instance, what is the word which is there, real word which is there. For example, when we are saying increase it, we can say that when we lemmatize it, we are going to get the word increases. Increase. So similarly, some of the functions are there. And when we are saying lambda functions in Python, we are saying about function which can be written in one line, for example, very shortly. And when we are saying about that particular function, we are going to use that particular list of things which are there inside the function, and then we're going to use it in a big way. We can also write this particular function in Python, and when we are writing this particular function, we can start it with def, and then when we are talking about using this particular function, we can just use the particular word that we have started the function with, and we can pass the argument, and then we can go ahead and get our results very easily. You can also pass the dictionary to the particular functions, and when you're passing a dictionary, you are basically passing both the words, which are basically the main word and then the subword which is there, and you're passing it to the dictionary, and then you're getting the result. Lambda function, we did talk about that. These are single line functions, and these single line functions are the functions which are basically going to be used in such a way that when we use the lambda function, we will be able to get our results very easily. And you can also use map. What it really does is it calls a given function every element of a sequence. For example, in this particular example, we are going to use a particular function, a map, and that map will be called for one separately, for two separately, for three separately, and that's how we'll get the result. We can also write this. These are some of the reference books that I have. And I have given you a refresher course in Python also, since you already learned Python in your class and you have already installed Python on your laptop. So I can say that this particular thing is basically a cakewalk for you. Now, I just wanted to let you know that when you're doing classification, it is very easy for you to go ahead and try to do the classification of a particular data that you have done. And for all this, you need to have Python installed on the laptop, which I believe you already have done this. And now what you need to do as a part of the assignment is that, as a part of the assignment, you need to take a particular data set. And from where do you take this particular data set? It's very easy. You take the data set from either Kaggle.com or UCI.com. And when you take the data set from either places, you take something which is going to do the classification or the supervised learning, and then you try to find out the different things which are there, and most importantly, you try to find out the accuracy of the particular data which is there, and then the most accurate algorithm is what you will be using, and then you also find out like which actually gives the highest amount of accuracy, and that accuracy wherein you get the highest is what you really take. So this is what the assignment I want to give you, and I want you to form groups, and when you're forming the groups, you basically do the assignment and then you basically present it. This is basically what I am expecting from you next week, is what I am saying you to do. Now, just one thing I want to show you. Okay, I'll give it as a homework for you, that a particular data set which is there, what data set, what are the different measures of accuracy which are there? And when you say accuracy measures, for example, precision, recall, FN score, are certain accuracy measures which are there for data set and for classification. No, I'm not telling any thing from the presentation. I want that students should show some of the things to me. Although I can speak from a presentation, but I want them to go ahead and read the books that I have given to them so that they are able to give me some of the measures, and they need to do it in Python. And as they've already learned Python, and I've done some of the refresher course in Python for them today, I want them to go ahead and take a particular data set from Kaggle or from UCI, that is University of California. These are some of the data sets you need to take, and then you need to apply certain of the algorithm on them, and you also need to go ahead and see that whichever is the highest algorithm percentage that is used, that is the algorithm that is best suited. You also need, first thing. Second thing, you also need to create the confusion matrix. And I'll talk about this confusion matrix later on. Or I could talk about right now also. For example, in confusion matrix, there are four places. For confusion matrix, I don't know where this particular presentation is. Stop sharing. Okay. Yeah. Now the assignment that I'm giving you is basically having twofold. One, I already spoke about it, that you need to take one of the data sets and then you need to apply the different matrix on them. And you need to come up with the algorithm which is most suitable for the particular data set which you have taken. Number one. Number two is basically you need to read about the confusion matrix a little bit. And then after you have read that confusion matrix, you need to find out the accuracy that's there when you apply a particular algorithm. And that accuracy is what you need to apply for 2-3 algorithms. And you need to tell us which algorithm is the best suitable for a particular fashion. Now, to give you a brief idea about the confusion matrix. Confusion matrix is something like a matrix which is there, which is basically going to give about the accuracy of a particular algorithm that we have used. You can read about it in the books that I have given to you, and you'll be able to get more information about the confusion matrix. You will also be able to get more information about the different matrices that we should be taking, the different matrix that we are taking. And this is the assignment that you have for the next week. And you need to basically come up and you need to present yourself. And you can form groups, which Suzaka sir will be forming the groups. And you have to do this assignment in the group wise. Any questions or any doubts that you have? Sudhakar sir, any question that any of the students may have regarding the particular assignment for the next week? Are you clear about the assignment that you need to do for the next week? If you want me to repeat, please let me know. If not, I'm thinking that you are very clear about the assignment that you need to do. And this is regarding classification. You want me to repeat? Okay. Take a particular data set from the Kaggle.com, or you take it from UCI. Once you have taken the particular data set, you need to perform the classification or supervised learning on that particular data set. Number one, you need to apply 3 different type of algorithms to that particular data set. And when you apply the three different data set, you need to find the algorithm, the accuracy that you are getting for each of the different algos or algorithms that you apply on that particular data set. The higher the accuracy percentage, the algorithm is most suitable for that, number one. Number two, for the data set, you need to also create the confusion matrix. The confusion matrix is required for accuracy creation of the algorithm. Once you create the confusion matrix, you will be able to get true positive, true negative, false positive, and false negative. And with that, you need to get the accuracy of the particular algorithm. And once you get the accuracy for that, that is basically the assignment that you need to do. So for a particular data set, apply three different algorithms, and then you will get the highest one is basically the algorithm that we should be applying to classify that particular data set. Number one. Number two is create the confusion matrix and get the different parameters. And then once the confusion matrix is done, we derive the accuracy from that. And this is all to be done using Python. Is that clear? We are only on the first one, that is the supervised learning. And we are trying to give you a particular assignment. And when you do this particular assignment, you will be getting in-depth knowledge about the data set. And the first type of learning, which is basically the supervised learning, which is there. Sudhakar sir, is it clear to all the students the assignment that was talked about? Hello? Yeah, this will at least motivate them to go ahead and read about Sure. I will basically give it to you, and whichever way you want to give it to all the students, you can send it to all the students. But I hope all the students are clear about the assignment that they need to do. And when you do the assignment, then only you can learn. You can just listen to me for hours together and just you'll forget it. But when you do, you'll remember it. Yes. Yes. Since they already have Python, I just went through Python as a refresher for them once again. Yeah, please. Thank you, sir. Correctly. Any questions, please? Okay, thank you very much. If there are no questions, I'll send across the assignment to you, and you can send it to every of the student, and they can do it, and request them to do it, and we'll be giving you more such assignments in the coming classes, and then you have to present it. And the good part about it is it will help in your knowledge of machine learning and AI, and it will also help you in your knowledge of presentation skills, and you can develop both of this when you present it online. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
I had a doubt, sir. Sir, you are sending regarding prop. You are sending. I mean, you are defining the problems regarding what the sir said, no? The exercise problems. Okay. Sir will send the assignments, and you are forwarding onto the group, no? Okay. And I think what I had understood through the service is that we want to send the assignment based on the supervised learning, and we want to get some what are the data sets required for those assignments. We get somewhere like Coggle and etc. Right now. Okay. And these people form the groups. Okay, only 50 people are there in today's, I think overall both faculty and students, I have seen only of 50 people. only 50 are attended. I think so 5 mentors are taken away. Only 45 students are there. 42, maybe 40 students are there only. And remaining all our faculty. Okay. They won't be there.